Hi, and welcome to this edition's interview section of the show. We are showing you a picture of early Stampeders that has in it my three guests today. We left Calgary in 66 as a six-man band. I've often spoken about it, and a lot of people have wondered, where are these three mysterious extra guys that were from the six-man band? We have them with us today, Van Lewis and Race Holiday and BJ Lyttle, all performers in their own rights from those days. And Van, when did you exactly leave the band?
It was early 1969, Ronnie.
69.
Yeah.
And I guess you still dabbled. I know a lot of your background, be the fact that you and I are brothers.
Right.
So I know that you still dabbled in the music biz, but certainly didn't get into it as strongly as the rest of us who continued on, of course, with the three-man band and so on.
I've spent about $50,000 in this last decade.
$50,000.
And I think I got about $50 back from royalties.
Uh-huh.
But I've had a lot of fun,
yes.
You know, managing groups and playing amateur psychiatrists with some of these boys.
Yes.
But it was an awful lot of fun. I've done some production and
yes.
Directing, had my own record label, and I've done some heavy metal boys and your normal run-of-the-mill type music, and as well as my own. I did some recording in Toronto at Round Sound with Bob Federer and Dominic Triano, the guitar player, and we did Pretty Woman.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as I was going to put it out, Pretty Woman, on my own label, along with Mel Shaw's label, MWC, the David Lee Roth came out with it. And, of course, it was a little bit raunchier than what I had in mind, so I sort of let it go. I came out with a couple of songs, Solitary Feeling. I had a song out in a movie, Tony Cromwriter's movie, All in Good Taste. Had a lot of fun, but I'm in real estate right now, still in music, but real estate makes me definitely my bread and butter, and I'm still blowing it in the music scene, but I love it.
Gee.
So I know where you're coming from, and I'm proud of you, Ronnie. You're doing a great job in this city.
Thanks a lot. Well, as you know, those of us that did continue on, it was really no bed of roses, even though it appeared to be a lot of the times. And Race, I'm sure that probably some of your reasons for having left the band were probably the hardships and the trials and tribulations that come with struggling on the road, as we all did as a six-man unit, sometimes having to double up and triple up in rooms and split up mattresses because we were so poor, and a hard life that we actually struggled along on those dues for.
Well, tearing those mattresses in two is one of the reasons I left the group. That was such hard work.
Yeah.
But seriously, Ronnie, we did have our trials and tribulations, like any group that's trying hard to make the big time, and it did have a wearing down on me after a number of years. I got into managing and supervising and eventually running my own business, so I got out of the music business pretty well entirely, and raised a family over the years, and have had a pretty interesting life. But it's really interesting to see your show and to see your group playing in Calgary, and to listen to the old hits on the radio. They're still there. The music will never die away, and
well,
it's great.
Nice of you to mention, but of course people should also know that you have a valid close connection with the three-man band that made it, in that you're Kimberly's brother as well, and that's how we left Calgary, in fact, as the six-man Van, myself, two brothers, Race and Kim, two brothers, and of course BJ Lyttle. Weren't you related to Richard Dodson in some way, shape, or form?
Somehow I've since forgotten.
More in a soulful sense. How are you, Brendan?
Well, I'm fine.
Nice to see you.
To set the record straight, yes, being one of the original Stampeders, I did quit the band twice. Not many guys can claim that, but having been the original bass player for the first two and a half, three years,
yes.
Then came back to Calgary, and then went back to Toronto in the early 70s, and hung around on weekends with you guys, and then did eventually become your somewhat of a road manager, working with Mel in Toronto, setting up your bookings, promotions for the next tour or whatever.
And a marvelous job you did. I recall that vividly, you working out of our office.
Getting the roadies their food at the next gig, counting the heads at the gate, and catching promoters cheating is and did all that kind
of
stuff.
Sure, they give you a big title and give you all the lowest jobs.
Somebody had to do it.
Yeah, well, that's terrific. And what these days you're still dabbling in showbiz. I know you are after your...
Several facets, yeah.
Yes?
Got into the disc jockey business. You were instrumental in that back in the 60s. Late 60s, I did a gig in Yorkville.
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember that? I won't go into it, but did a booking, and that started me. And then that was in the days of Fly Robin Fly. But from there on, I started my own disc jockey business here in Calgary, and it's done me well.
Yeah.
And you do about 120 bookings a year, and it helps pay the bills.
Well, and terrific. I remember all of us being very, very, very excited leaving Calgary as six green little guys who just didn't know from nothing, basically just following Mal Shaw's word and saying, yeah, we're going to go and make the big time. And we arrived in Toronto, if you all recall, in a limousine that we had bought from an oil company, a Cadillac limousine, which burnt more oil than it did gas, and we called it Old Smoker, I believe. Brendan, I recall going down the street with you one time and the wheel fell off, and
the
wheel fell off in Ottawa. Well, we arrived in Toronto, and it was just big, big time to us, because we first drove down Yonge Street and saw the big neon lights of Sam the Record Man and A&A Records, and this was Las Vegas to us, and then got to go to Yorkville, the village where we were to be playing at
The patio.
The El Patio nightclub and so on else. And I'm sure you, as I do, have vivid memories of that. And so, I don't know.
Well, you could almost see the audience through the smoke.
Almost, in those days. Well, I remember, of course, the Poppers, who turned into Lighthouse. Gordon Lightfoot used to play across the street. David Clayton Thomas.
I called him Tom.
You called him Tom. My goodness.
I was talking to him, and I said, well, we'll see you later, Tom.
Yeah.
Quite funny. Joni Mitchell across the street, David Clayton Thomas, all these people, you know, used to just see him for a dollar. Pay a buck, sit there, have a cup of coffee, espresso, and see talents like that. Unbelievable. That was the village in 66.
Do you remember the dishwasher at the El Patio? Bernie Finkelstein.
Oh.
Went on to become president of True North Records.
Yes.
With Murray McLaughlin and all sorts of artists like that.
Unbelievable.
He was the dishwasher.
Yes.
So, well, basically, you're still pursuing as much showbiz career as possible.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Terrific. I know that you have some product. If we get a chance to play any, we might try to insert a little bit here and there, because we're loose with these interviews here. Race, yourself... just continuing with your business life, I see, and obviously making money at it with this beautiful suit you have, which I can't afford, but you can, so.
Well, thanks, Ronnie. I'm working as a manufacturer's rep for Creative Playthings. We sell playground equipment to institutions and commercial accounts and municipalities, and quite enjoying that.
Terrific. PJ, you were just recently in Los Angeles.
Yes, took the chance of my life, went down to L.A. for 3 or 4 weeks.
To promote and try to sell?
My first screenplay. I've come up with 6 or 7 good movie ideas, concepts.
Yes.
For development for movies, and have written 3 treatments, and now my first screenplay. So I was down there knocking on doors, meeting agents, asking the right and sometimes the wrong questions.
Yes.
Got into Warner Brothers in Burbank, and they gave me 45 minutes to let me make my pitch. So it's all in all, everything that I did in L.A. to help me getting ready for my next step.
Terrific.
I'm doing a big mailing at the end of this month.
Sensational. Well, who knows? Maybe we can just one day plan some kind of a mass recording session of some sort. I've got this song written that we could all maybe kick in and kick around on. But meanwhile, I had tried my darndest to see whether any of the boys felt like performing, even though they all are very, very talented in their own right. They said, well, you know, it's been a few years and all that kind of stuff. Who knows? The night of the show, which is still to be taped, and hope that you're all going to be there and join us, of course. Who knows? Perhaps we'll get the guys up and kick along and jam with one or two of the songs. I very much enjoyed interviewing Mr. Van Lewis, Race Holiday, and BJ Lyttle, and we thank you, gentlemen, very, very much for coming and appearing on Ronnie King Live 5.
Thank you.
Well. Thanks, Ronnie.
Thank you.
much, ladies and gentlemen. Hope you enjoyed the show. See you all again next time. Thank you.
If you would like to be a member of the audience for Ronnie King Live, be in front of the Trade Winds Hotel and look for the original Partridge Family Bus sometime between 12 and 1 o'clock. Be watching for the next Ronnie King Live show when special guests could be Eric Clapton, Paul McCartney, Rod Stewart, Tina Turner, Natalie Scurry, Boxcar Willie.